as he was in the boat, and there were other boats with him. Then it began to blow a gale, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that it was almost swamped. But he was in the stern, his head on the cushion, asleep. They woke him and said to him, "Master, do you not care? We are going down." And he woke up and rebuked the wind and the sea and said to the sea, "Quiet now, be calm." The wind dropped and all was calm again. Then he said to them, "Why are you so frightened? How is it that you have no faith?" They were filled with awe and said to one another, "Who can this be? Even the wind and the sea obey him." The Gospel of the Lord. I would like you to ask yourself this question. Do you really believe? Do you really believe that Jesus Christ is God who became a man and lived among us, and that he is truly God from God, the almighty eternal God from whom everything comes, who created the whole universe? Do you believe this? It's a very important question, and you do need to ask yourself this. We live in a world of complete unbelief. Our world does not believe in God, nor does it believe in Jesus Christ, and it holds him in utter contempt. This modern world is brainwashed. Brainwashed by the media. Most people believe everything they see and hear through the media. There is no doubt about this. Just let me take one thing. I am completely disbelieving in evolution. I do not accept it at all. And the reason I do not accept evolution as having any truth in it whatsoever is that there is, if evolution was true, there would be evidence of it everywhere. It would be a constant reality. Everything would be continually evolving. Nothing is evolving. Everything is developing, like a human being develops from a little dot and grows. And what is interesting about our existence is from the moment we are conceived, everything exists. Everything exists. Nothing is missing. And we simply develop and grow. But we do not evolve into something else. There is no evidence on the face of the earth of anything evolving from one kind of creature to another. And I reject it. Because I believe that God is the creator of everything. And that he holds everything in being. And he controls everything in this world. And nothing happens without him. That's what I believe. That's what Christians believe, true Christians believe. We accept empirical evidence, scientific evidence that is there. But when there's no evidence of something, the reason most people accept is because they're brainwashed. And so the question is, do you believe? Now, the apostles were on one side of the Sea of Galilee, which is a freshwater lake in reality. It's huge. And it's famous for the storms that suddenly build up in it, but come out of nowhere. The boat they got into, that Jesus got into, would have been about from here to my chair away. That's how big it was, and about 7 foot wide. I don't know what that is in centimetres. I grew up in the old empirical system. So, I don't know, probably about as wide as from the altar to the altar rails, almost that wide. So from here to there, that's how big it was. Our Lord was in the stern, the back of the boat. And at the back of the boat, there was a flat part built up as there was in the front. And so you could store things underneath as well. So they're quite decent sized boats and had a mast in the middle or probably towards the front with sails as well as oars for rowing, just so that you get a picture. So our Lord was in this boat with the apostles. They were crossing from one side of the Sea of Galilee to the other. And he was lying down on a cushion and fell asleep because he was fully human in everything except sin. And this storm suddenly came out of nowhere. And it was a big one. And the waves were crashing over the boat and the water was going into the boat. But our Lord was on that little ledge area. So he wasn't getting wet, except by the rain perhaps. And he wasn't at all worried. He was relaxed. Have you ever been in a storm that's blowing and it suddenly gives you a sense of peace? I've had that lovely experience. It's a nice experience sometimes. And he's God. He's not worried at all. Not a bit. And he knows his disciples very well. And he knows what he's going to do. So he's completely relaxed, enjoying a little sleep. And the apostles are going out of their minds in worry. The water keeps crashing into the boat. They can't get it out. And they're afraid of sinking. And so they wake him. That's not the problem. What he corrects them on is their lack of faith. Now he gets up, stands up in the boat, and he addresses nature. He talks to the wind and the sea. Be quiet, be calm now. If you or I did that, nothing would happen. And if anyone watched us do it, they'd laugh their heads off at us and think we were entirely mad. But Jesus is God. He's not just God, he is the creator. He is in control of everything. And at his word, nature obeys. And instantly, there was calm. He's just shown the apostles exactly who he is. He's not just a prophet. He's not just the king, son of David. He's not just a holy man. He is God Almighty. He has power over creation that he created. And there, they were terrified by the waves. Now they're terrified at who he really is, the Almighty. And they kneel before him. And they're in wonder and awe, and they are afraid. And this is holy. And one of the problems modern man has, he has no fear of God. None at all. And on one level, I could be shocked by how many Catholics have no fear of God. But I'm not. How many Catholics completely ignore the law of God? They ignore the Ten Commandments. They don't care. How many so-called devout Catholics suits them? Not only by being sexually promiscuous or committing adultery in their minds and heart and lustful. What about the moral law about fertility? How many Catholics will use someone else's egg or use IVF, or use contraception? Across the board, they ignore the moral law because they have no fear of God. How many Catholics cheat and steal in business and call it business? No care of what is right or wrong. How many Catholics go to Holy Communion when they shouldn't, even though they are in mortal sin? They don't go to confession. How many Catholics miss Mass on Sunday, even though it is the commandment of God, and think nothing of it? They put sport, they put visitors, they put anything before their their bounden duty to worship and adore and give thanks and praise to the living God in the way he has laid out. And this is the other problem. This is the pride. This is the arrogance of so many. They want to do it their way, always their way, my way. My way is above everybody else and above what Christ laid down with his holy apostles. And the church has kept faithful over 2,000 years. It's the constant problem. The sin of Lucifer, who was the greatest angel of God's creation, was pride. He said, "I will not serve." And he rejected God and God's plan. And the sin he leads so many people into is exactly the same. Pride. I've heard it said money is the root of all evil, but it isn't. It's pride. And it's the most serious vice of so many. And the church, unfortunately, is riddled with men and women who are so full of pride and are on that wide and spacious road to perdition. And you see, this is the other thing. I've always been astounded how priests can be so dumb that they say, oh, everyone's going to heaven, no one's going to hell, when Christ taught exactly the opposite. Not that everyone's going to hell, but the road to hell is wide and spacious and many take it, and the road to life is narrow and difficult and few find it. That's what Christ taught us. He never, ever promised everyone they're going to heaven. In fact, he said, if you want eternal life, this is what you have to do. And so many people don't want to do what they have to do, and yet if they think of life after death, they presume, zip, straight to heaven, not worrying about it at all. And how often do you see that, you know, at funerals? Oh my gosh, you don't go to as many funerals as I have been to. And again and again and again, oh, they're in heaven now. No concept of judgment, of what the person has to face at judgment. No thought. And that is borne out too by the fact that these days very few families call priests to their dying relatives. Do you know how rare it is that we're called out to the dying these days? It's so sad. And if we're called out often, it's already when they're dead. And I tell you, we can't do anything for dead bodies. It's a waste of time. And then you've got these stupid superstitions. Don't call the priest, they'll die if you call the priest. What utter nonsense. What nonsense people have in their heads. And now the church is going through probably one of the worst times of its whole existence. She's riddled with apostates. That means people who do not accept or believe the true faith. And unfortunately, those apostates are right through her ranks. Bishops, clergy, religious and laity, teaching falsehood. Look at what's going on in Germany. The bishops wanting to bless homosexual unions out of compassion. It's utter nonsense. It's nonsense. There can only be one marriage. And there are no ifs and buts. What is required for a marriage is a male and a female and a physical union. That's it. There is no other form of marriage. And this concept of a person's sexual desire defining who they are. Have you ever heard of anything so insane in your life? Who cares what desires you have in your heart and mind? I certainly couldn't give a hoot. It does not define you. You are a human being, male or female, made in God's image and likeness. Sexual desire given into in lust is always sinful, irrelevant where it's directed. Love, chaste love, is always blessed by God, and anyone can love chastely anyone. So it's actually entirely irrelevant. The devil deceives people all the time. And these bishops are wrong. The moral law is not laid out by anyone but Christ, and it cannot change. And our task is to change, is to become holy, is to find mercy. The fundamental Christian attitude is one of repentance throughout our whole lives. That's what Christ calls us to, and to grow in holiness, to overcome ourselves, our base desires, to learn to become the people that Christ is calling us to. The poor apostles, they struggled, they lived with Christ, they struggled, but he was always there for them. He never abandoned them. Even at his agony, he said, "Can't you keep awake for 1 hour and pray not to be put to the test?" They were so weak. Peter, the one chosen by Christ to be the head of his church, completely denied our Lord 3 times. But Christ never abandoned him. Do you understand? Don't pretend you don't sin. Don't pretend you're something other than you are, but come to him humbly. St. John Bosco had a couple of very alarming prophetic dreams which really speak of our age. One was the Pope, the clergy, religious, and the laity leaving Rome, all of them, under great attack. And then at one stage the Pope turns around and all the crowd that was going with him was gravely diminished. Pope Benedict XVI said he believes the church is going to get very small. We have come out of an era when the church was magnificent. We had a pope like St. John Paul II, extraordinary man, one we all felt so proud of as our father on earth. Now we are going in another direction, and the church is diminishing before us. And as I said, there are many apostates in the church who do not believe, who do not accept the truth anymore, and her numbers are going down. And the second prophetic dream St. John Bosco had, again about the church, was he saw this great ocean, and in the ocean there were many, many, many boats and many vessels of all kinds. And the biggest vessel of all was the Catholic Church, this great ship he saw her as. It was a symbolic dream. And there were some vessels around the ship protecting it, going with it. But there were so many without number attacking the ship, attacking the church, firing cannons and weapons. And what's interesting in his dream, he says, firing books and pamphlets. In other words, the attack would also be an intellectual attack on the church, not just a physical attack. And there in the ocean were two great columns. The highest of the columns and the biggest, on the top of it was a Eucharistic host. And underneath it was written something like "Your Salvation." And the smaller column, a little away from it, was an image of the Blessed Virgin Mary. And underneath her was written "Help of Christians." And when the church was able, the boat was able to get between the two posts and anchor on them, then the enemy suddenly panicked and fled for their lives, and there was calm. And St. John Bosco was teaching us that during these horrific times, more than ever, we need our Blessed Mother, whom Christ has given his church, and the Blessed Eucharist, without which we cannot have life. And when the faithful turn back to the very heart of our faith, then the enemies will flee. The many enemies the church has. We are in the midst of all this. We are not yet anchored to the Eucharist and the Blessed Mother. Individuals are, but the church is still on this journey, and we are under immense attack. Immense attack from the outside and from within. I mean, look at what happened to poor Cardinal Pell. Have you ever seen anything so horrific, so unjust, so wrong? An innocent man condemned, and not because there was any evidence, but because they were determined to condemn him because they simply hated him. The unjust reality of what goes on in our world. Brothers and sisters, nothing is more important than our faith. And we need to put it first, no matter what. And to trust Jesus. He will set things right. But we have to believe and trust him. Not that he requires it, but we need that so that we can remain with him always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Pray the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. The wind and the sea obeyed our Lord. In the storms of our day, let us pray with confidence.
That the church will be strengthened and united in every land. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all Australians will accept the gospel and strive to live it. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the young will respond to Christ's call and follow him. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our brethren who are suffering for their faith will be protected, comforted, and freed from oppression. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all the sick and dying will be comforted and healed by our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our deceased relatives, friends, benefactors, and parishioners will be granted eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, favorably listen to your children and grant them your saving power through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The love of God abides, the love.
Sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, O Lord, the sacrifice of conciliation and praise, and grant that cleansed by its action, we may make offering of a heart pleasing to you, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering cancelled out our sins. By his rising from the dead he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise as without end we acclaim. Fount of all holiness, make holy therefore these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis our Pope and Vincent our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. That with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. In Him no sin is found, we stand on holy ground. Of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He burns with holy fire, with splendor He shining all around. Be still, for the power of the Lord is more.
bring one notice to your attention. That's Sunday school. This is the last Sunday because it's the end of school term, and it will start again on the 18th of July. And any of you who aren't coming along, if you have children, you want to be taught the Catholic faith, come along to our Sunday school, infants, primary and high school. We have three groups. It's wonderful. I think the kids are enjoying it. I enjoy it when I go and teach up there too, so I really encourage you. Let us pray. Renewed and nourished by the sacred body and precious blood of your Son, we ask of your mercy, O Lord, that what we celebrate with constant devotion may be our sure pledge of redemption through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Lord be with you. Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Salve Regina, Mater Misericordiae, Vita Dulcedo et Spes nostra salve. A te clamamus, exsules filii Evae, a te suspiramus, gementes afflentes.